Hi, Terry Schultz on behalf of the international press. A question for both sides, obviously. To the Turkish foreign minister, your own citizens are demonstrating in the streets asking you to do more militarily against the threat of ISIS. Why does Turkey seem so reluctant? Why are you so reluctant to make further commitments on the ground? And if we do see a massacre happening just across your border, will you intervene? And to the NATO Secretary General, you say that ISIS does pose a threat to the NATO community, to the entire region. Beyond the Patriot missile commitment, which obviously is solid, what more is NATO willing to do? Does with ISIS, if Kobani falls, ISIS controls a large swath of NATO's border with Syria. What kind of threat does this pose to the alliance? What more are you willing to do? And does Turkey have a responsibility to NATO, as well as NATO having a responsibility to Turkey to repel this threat? Thank you.
Çok teşekkür ediyorum. Her şeyden önce Türkiye.
Thank you very much. Once and for all, with respect to fighting against terrorism and with respect to the issues and events that have been taking place just across our border, we have never been reluctant. 46 citizens were kept as hostage by the ISIS, and we were cautious during that period. But even during that period, in Iraq and in Syria, we always underlined to our colleagues, to our allies, what needs to be done. And this was always the expression that we shared from Jeddah to Paris to New York. And with respect to the developments in Iraq and Syria and the current picture in front of us, we have actually been sharing this for the last 4 years with some of our colleagues and our allies. Today, we see that some allies are underlining that they really mistook the information that were provided to them by Turkey, and they understated the importance of this attack. We have a comprehensive strategy for the region, and in order to provide security, we need this comprehensive strategy. The political change that is taking place in Iraq is a new beginning for Iraq, and this is something that has to be evaluated. And the policies of the new administration is going to identify the future of Iraq, and we support them. Today, as long as the Assad regime stays in Syria, the bloodshed, the tearshed, and the massacre will continue. And the Assad regime has killed more than 200,000 people. We're talking about mass killings. They have killed 200,000 people with different methods, with chemical weapons, with air bombardments, and with barrel bombs. And today, the Assad regime is the region of the instability in Syria and in the region, and the radical terrorist groups have gained strength over this instability. Therefore, there is a necessity of a political change, and the Geneva Declaration is an important basis for this. As long as the Assad regime stays in power, this current status quo will continue. There were different groups at the beginning. We now have different groups in the area, and we can never guess where the terrorist groups will target and will continue to fight. We have underlined repeatedly that we do support the air bombardment of our allies, but this is a problem which you cannot resolve just by air bombardments, and you cannot change the balance of power in the region with these air bombardments. Maybe you can stop them for a short period, but you cannot clean the whole region from ISIS or some other terrorist organizations. You need to take into consideration all options, including an operation on the ground, and we should support the Free Syrian Army. There is a humanitarian dimension, and Turkey has never acted reluctantly on this issue. And just recently, we have received more than 200,000 Syrians from the Kobani region. And as we have supported our brothers coming from Syria, from Iraq formerly, we do continue to support these groups. Turkey has never made any discrimination on the sectarian basis or has been made any discrimination. This is an important burden. Today we have spent more than $4 billion for our brothers coming from that area. And the aid that has been conveyed to Turkey is just around $200 million. And but we cannot expect Turkey to act as the United Nations forever. In terms of the intervention, we did share our opinion and we do continue. For instance, we need to establish a safe zone, a no-fly zone. This is important for the immigrants as well as for the internally displaced people, for their secure logistic settlement, which is important for humanitarian reasons, and it is important for the success of the operation. So we cannot expect Turkey to do a land operation. This is not a realistic approach. And with all these comprehensive proposals, we do have our consultations. Once we reach a joint decision, Turkey will continue to act and do its utmost. But our strategy and what needs to be done is to clearly also explain to our colleagues what has to be done in the region. Knowing that this is an advantage, there are some brothers that are fighting amongst each other and they're trying to attack the property of Turkey and to our security forces. And what we want to say to them is that they need to evaluate that who's actually siding by the people in Kobani. And Turkey will continue to provide humanitarian aid to Kobani and the region. So taking advantage of this would not be a good approach, and we will not let anybody to intervene in this. This is a message that I want to share once again from here.
First of all, I would like to underline that the core responsibility of NATO is collective security. And Turkey is a strong ally. Turkey has the second largest army in the alliance. But of course, NATO as an alliance is always ready to support any ally in defending themselves. And that's the reason why, as you mentioned, we have deployed Patriot systems in Turkey to enhance the air defense of Turkey. But Turkey being a strong nation itself, having a strong army itself, of course also have great capability itself to defend itself, but we will always be ready to support Turkey in defending itself, because that's part of the alliance and it's part of the collective security which the alliance is built on. We have close dialogue with Turkey. The situation is evolving, so I'm quite confident that Turkey feel that NATO is standing behind them and that we are working together with Turkey to defend, to help Turkey defend itself against any threat, also threats from ISIL. Then I would like to commend Turkey for what Turkey is doing as a part of the broad international effort to help people in need and to fight ISIL. I welcome that Turkey has shown so great hospitality and received a large number of refugees. And I welcome also, as I said, the vote of the parliament in Turkey to authorize Turkey to take even more active part in the broad international effort to fight ISIL and to create a more stable situation in the region. I would also like to underline that there is no easy way out, and it's a long-term effort. It's going to take time, and we need, in the long run, a political solution. NATO has stated that we are ready to help Iraq enhancing their security forces to assist Iraq in increasing their ability to defend themselves. We are already working and cooperating on the coordination of assistance, of airlift, of assistance into the region. And we are also working on enhancing our cooperation when it comes to fighting the threat which the homecoming of foreign fighters is posing on our nations. So there is already a broad cooperation with Turkey, with other allies, with partners in the region to contribute to a more stable and less insecure situation in the region.
Efendim, benim sorum, Sayın Genel
Sekreteri olacak. My question is to the Secretary General.
Sayın Çavuşoğlu da ifade etti,
Mr. Çavuşoğlu also mentioned that from the very beginning, Turkey has demands of a no-fly zone and a safe zone. Do you believe that this no-fly zone is going to be an important solution to many of the problems that is facing in the region? You have also said that you are protecting your relationship with Turkey. Could you give a much more concrete example as to when would NATO be ready to intervene on side by Turkey?
So first of all, I would like to underline what I already said, that NATO is already deploying Patriot missiles in Turkey. And that's a very concrete sign of NATO solidarity. And that's on the request of Turkey almost 2 years ago, when Turkey wanted to increase its air defense capacity. And that's the reason why we have deployed, and that's also the reason why we are working on to continuing to deploy Patriot missiles in Turkey. And that's against the still existing threat of missile attacks against Turkey. So it's not a question of when NATO is going to show NATO solidarity. We are already showing that by deploying our Patriot missile systems in Turkey. And that's one concrete contribution. But then, as I said in the previous answer, is that Turkey is a strong ally. Turkey has the second largest army in the alliance. So what we are doing is to help and to support Turkey in defending itself. Second, I have, of course, heard and seen that there has been calls for a no-fly zone or a safe zone. It was also discussed in the meetings I had this morning with the foreign minister. I believe there is no simple and straightforward ways out of the problems we are seeing in Syria and around Kobane these days. It has not been on the table of any NATO discussions yet, and it's not an issue which is discussed in NATO. So I just welcome what I see as very decisive actions from several countries now in an international effort to fight ISIL by airstrikes. And I also welcome what Turkey is doing in receiving a high number of refugees and also the decision by the Turkish parliament to authorize Turkey to play an even more active role in stabilizing the situation in the region.
Thank you.